Thank you. Good morning.
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 Boy, it is an hour early. That sounded an hour early. Welcome to worship. If it feels like it's an hour early, it probably is. But as someone reminded me this morning, did the clocks change? There's a sign that spring is not too far away. Just ignore the snow that shows up tonight. So welcome to worship on this second Sunday in Lent. Don't know that I have a lot of introductions to things. Thank you for our musicians this morning. The screen will guide you in the service, and I invite you to stand for our gathering song, Lord Most High. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy. For the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you, and for his sake God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Have mercy on us, Lord.
Lord be with you.
And also
let us pray. O God, our leader and guide, in the waters of baptism, you bring us to new birth to live as your children. Strengthen our faith in your promises, that by your Spirit we may lift up your life to all the world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for our musical offering.
Out the door, I'm feeling like I'm falling behind. It's a crazy life. 90 miles an hour, going fast as I can. Try and push a little harder, trying to get the upper hand. So much to do in so little time. It's a crazy life. It's ready, set, go with another wild day. When the stress is on the rise, in my heart I feel safe. Just breathe, come and rest at my feet, and be, just be. Chaos calls, but all you really need is to just breathe. Cup of joe, just get me through the day. Wanna make the most of time, but I feel it slip away. I wonder if there's something more to this crazy life. I'm busy, 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 and it's no surprise to see that I only have time for me, me, me. There's gotta be something more to this crazy life. Hanging on tight to another wild day, and it starts to fall apart in my heart. I hear you say, just breathe, just breathe. Come and rest at my feet, and be, just be. Chaos calls, but all you really need, take it in and fill your lungs, the peace of God that overcomes. Just breathe. Let your weary spirit rest, lay down what's good and find what's best. Just breathe. breathe, just breathe. Come and rest at my feet and be, just be. Chaos calls, but all you really need, just breathe, just breathe.
Thank you. Our first reading is from Genesis, and in this passage we hear God's call of Abraham and Sarah. It's Abram and Sarai. And they're given a clear purpose, that through them all the families of the earth will gain a blessing. As they set out on their journey, they are accompanied by promises of land, nation, and a great reputation. Paul points to Abraham in this passage from Romans. In the person and example of Abraham, we discover that a right relationship with God does not involve earning a reward from God, but entails trusting God's promises. Abraham is the forebearer and model of both Jews and Gentiles, because we too trust that ours is a God who gives life to the dead. We hear the word.
All the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abraham went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. The word of the Lord. Let's read responsively Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where is my help to come? The Lord will not let your foot be moved, nor will the one who watches over you fall asleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand.
The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will preserve you from all evil and will keep your life. Our second reading is from Romans 4, verses 1 through 5 and 13 through 17. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. It is the adherents of the law who are to be the, if it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, How can these things be? Jesus answered him, Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, the summary of this sermon is simply, I want you to die because Jesus wants you to die. Do I have your attention? Right? Not the way you would normally start a sermon on a Sunday morning. And probably not what you think is good news. So, to lighten the mood, we're going to begin with jokes, because people always want to hear jokes from the pulpit, and I never do jokes from the pulpit. So I got on the internet and looked up some jokes about Lutherans. Well, the one that came up the most often was about all kinds of Christians, but notice what it says about Lutherans. How many Pentecostals does it take to change a light bulb? You've heard these, right? One to change the bulb, and nine to pray against the spirit of darkness. How many Presbyterians does it take to change a light bulb? None. Lights will go on and off at predestined times. That's a predestination joke. For those who were at the LEAD conference yesterday, that's one of those double predestination things. How many Roman Catholics does it take to change a light bulb? None. There'll only be candles. I don't know Baptists well enough, but those who might know Baptists, how many Baptists does it take to change a light bulb? At least 15. One to change the light bulb, three committees to approve the change and decide who brings the potato salad and fried chicken. How many Mormons does it take to change a light bulb? One man to change the bulb and four wives to tell him how to do it. How many Amish does it take to change a light bulb? What's a light bulb? And Lutherans. How many Lutherans does it take to change a light bulb? None. Lutherans don't believe in change. I've heard that said a number of ways, right? And here's the amazing thing. That's out on the internet, so it's not like our in-joke. Everyone, whether you're Baptist, Presbyterian, Roman Catholic, would laugh at that joke, because the Lutherans, you know, were still dressing funny like it's the 16th century, and we're still pointing to 16th century documents and all this kind of stuff. We don't believe in change. But Jesus believes in change. Some of you were at the LEAD conference yesterday in Madison, and got to hear one of my professors of Lutheran theology and Lutheran history, Kurt Hendel. And it brought back all these theological thoughts, and those of you who were there probably went, I got blurry vision from all the theological thoughts. But Kurt Hendel reminded me that, so bear with some of my theological language here, that Lutherans talk very explicitly about forensic justification. That is justification that comes as an announcement from God, a pronouncement that makes it happen. Which is why Luther talks about us being at the same time saints and sinners. Forensic justification is a declaration by God that we are saved, that we are forgiven, that we are not guilty, without it changing us. Right? The forensic justification does not change us. So we are continually sinners, but God sees us through the filter, through the lens of Christ, and sees us as saints, at the same time saints and sinners. Most Lutherans have learned this understanding of grace, this understanding of justification, and we're really comfortable with it. Why? Because it requires no change on our part. And in fact, there is no requirement of change. But Luther understood that change would happen. We would be changed by this gospel proclamation. We would be changed by this good news. We would be changed by the Holy Spirit that bears this word into our lives. So that there is more than just this declaration from God. Now, as the internet would suggest, Lutherans don't believe in change. We don't like change. I know that. I've had over 20 years of ministry, and people remind me of that almost daily. We don't like change. What is it about change that we don't like? Well, I think it's fear and, honestly, laziness, right? The old sinful self just doesn't want to do whatever it is that needs to be done. Or we're afraid of the unknown. We're afraid of what might happen. Fear, we'll make a nicer word, fear and weakness. But behind fear and weakness is a lack of trust in God and a lack of belief in the power of the Holy Spirit in us. So let me suggest to you, when you feel overcome by fear of the unknown, about your reluctance to commit, when you exercise your dislike of change, look to your faith, your trust in God, who promises to see you through. So now we come to this story about Nicodemus, who comes to Jesus. And Jesus is teaching about his desire for us to die. And you say, Pastor, that's not what he says. He says we must be born from above in this translation. Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above, says our translation. Well, you probably have some of those evangelical neighbors who talk about being born again, right? You got to be born again. And it's exactly this line that they will point to when they want to talk about being born again. Because the two Greek words here can be translated born from above, born again, or born anew. Lutherans should fully understand being born anew and be able to embrace the born again. Because by God's declaration, we are born from above. We are only born when we die. So a little bit of Luther here to kind of help. Luther teaches in the Large Catechism that our baptism is a daily dying and rising with Christ. It is a daily dying to sin and rising to new life. I don't want to read too much of the Large Catechism, but if you've got a Large Catechism on your shelf at home, read Luther's Large Catechism on Baptism. He writes, "The power and operation of baptism is nothing else than putting to death the old Adam, and after that, the resurrection of the new man," this translation is from 1917, "the new person, both of which must take place in us all our lives, so that a truly Christian life is nothing else than a daily baptism, once begun and ever to be continued." This is Luther that says, our justification, our being proclaimed forgiven, is merely a declaration from God. But that declaration changes our lives daily, over and over again. Over and over again, we are born anew. When we drown the sinful person in us, we rise to live the life of Christ. Another next paragraph on, Luther writes, where men have become Christians, where people have become Christians, the old Adam in us daily decreases until he perishes. This is truly to be buried in baptism and daily to come forth again. Daily dying and rising. Jesus wants us to die so that we might live in him. Jesus wants a change in our lives so that we might become more like him. I mean, Paul says it this way, "It is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me." If we are afraid that Christ living in us will be something bad, we will want to resist such a change. If we are afraid we do not have what God has given us to follow Christ, we will resist change. But God's Spirit has been given to us. We have been washed in the water and the Spirit of baptism. God has given us faith and trust and confidence, even in the face of the unknown. And we are called to daily die and rise again in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That life was that real to Paul. "It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me," Paul writes. "The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." That's where we want to go. That's claiming that gospel word, that forensic pronouncement, as our own, as yours, as life, and life eternal. We need not be afraid to die. Because as Paul reminds us in our second reading, we believe in a God who gives life to the dead, who calls into existence the things that do not exist. A God who loves enemies and forgives sinners and calls you because you have all that you need to be a follower of Christ. You have all you need to drown the old evil person in you and to daily rise again with Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God has made us God's people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Lifting our voices and turning toward God, let us pray for the church, the earth, and all who are in need. God of Abraham and Sarah, God of all earth's families, bless your church to be a blessing, and bestow your grace to a hurting world. Hear our prayers of thanksgiving for the anniversary this week of the baptism of Lawrence Fry, Michael Lutke, Jessica Martin, Christine Harmel, Jennifer Lentz, Ann Brady, Allison Levinick, Scott Baumgartner, and Deborah Savage. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, you love the entire cosmos. Help us to love all the creatures and life within it. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, our help is in you. Keep the nations, their governments, and their people from all evil. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, your promises ease our pain and sorrow. Grant comfort, healing, and joy to all who are in need. We pray especially for the family of Paul, the family of John, the family of Linda, Fern, Barrett, Helen, Kathy, Heidi, Bob, Judy, Elaine, Blake, Constance, Elsie, Sandy, James, Terry, Carlene, Patty, Robert, Preston, Steve, Diane, Gloria, Melvin, Kathleen, Sandy, Phyllis, Maddie, Betty, Connie, and those we name now silently or aloud. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, lead this assembly in its Lenten journey toward faith, works of love, and prayer. Let those gathered here be fed and nourished by your word. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. O God, we give thanks for the faithful departed who have joined your saints in light. Let their lives be guides to our own. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Into your hands, merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your steadfast love, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share Christ's peace with our brothers and sisters. Thank you. As the musicians make their way back to their assigned place.
Peace be with you.
The usual reminders, all baptized Christians are welcome at the Lord's table. Please come and commune, receive the sacraments. Please fill in the welcome pad that's near the center aisle. Is our record of attendance and communion for the day.
Peace be with you.
We sing our song and receive our offering as we prepare for communion. Please stand as you're able and let us pray. Merciful God, receive the sacrifice of our praise and thanksgiving, the offering of our lives, that following in the way of the cross, we may know the joy of the resurrection through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the Thank you.
We give you thanks, Father, through Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, whom you sent in this end of the ages to save and redeem us and to proclaim to us your will. He is your word inseparable from you, through whom you created all things and in whom you take delight. He is your word sent from heaven to a virgin's womb. It there took on our nature and our lot and was shown forth as your Son, born of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary. He, our Lord Jesus, fulfilled all your will and won for your holy people. He stretched out his hands in suffering in order to free from suffering those who trust you. He is the one who was handed over to a death he freely accepted in order to destroy death, to break the bonds of the evil one, to crush hell underfoot, to give light to the righteous, to establish his covenant, and to show forth the resurrection. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering then his death and resurrection, we take this bread and cup, giving you thanks that you have made us worthy to stand before you and to serve you as your priestly people. Send your Spirit upon these gifts of your church. Gather into one all who share this bread and wine. Fill us with your Holy Spirit to establish our faith and truth, that we may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ, through whom all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your Holy Church, both now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Return to God with all your heart. Receive bread for the journey, drink for the desert. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
Thank you. Please stand as you're able. Let us pray. Compassionate God, you have fed us with the bread of heaven. Sustain us in our Lenten pilgrimage. May our fasting be hunger for justice, our alms a making of peace, and our prayer the song of grateful hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated for a couple of brief announcements this morning. Excuse me.
Randy, am I on?
That's good.
Might as well talk about the upcoming shelter that we host again on April 30th through the first week of May. And the sign-up board is out back. Everybody take a look at that. Please see where you can help out. And we already have a few names on there, so we should be in good shape again. Thank you.
Okay, I want to remind everybody. Is this on?
Yep, step forward. Are you busted? Or the battery's dying. No, now it's off. Okay, try that.
I want to remind everybody. It's not on.
Are we on upstairs? Number 9.
It's on.
There you go.
There it's on. I want to remind everybody that Meals and Wheels starts this Monday, tomorrow, and for the 2 weeks. And I know we got some bad weather coming. I hope you can all make it through that. And also, I need sign-ups for readers and greeters for April. And it's pretty well open out and back. So I'd please appreciate it if you would go back and sign up to read. Thank you.
Good morning. I want to call your attention to the birthday party at the bottom of the front of your yellow pages. If you'd like a big reminder that you can put on your refrigerator, I have some extras of these. We're celebrating Kathy's 70th birthday, and it's about Kathy, but really it's sort of about Mila too, as you can imagine, because everything's about Mila. So, you know, so if you could come, that'd be great. Mila would love to see you as well. Thank you.
We have the book fair. It's for the youth, for young people, but there is a book, oh good, Bob's gone, that I'm going to get. if you have a few minutes, take a look at the books that are for sale. In your bulletin, you got a notice about Advocacy Day from the Wisconsin Council of Churches. I've been going to it for a few years now. It is a remarkable day. If you like being with like-minded people and feel like you're actually doing something for others, I can't suggest this more strongly. There's a wonderful worship service that begins with, and then you break up into groups of what you're interested in, and then you go to the Capitol and talk to your representative and senator. So it's a great day. And finally, the youth, we have several youth who are interested in going to the world, to the youth gathering that's going to be in Houston, and there's only 30,000 kids. So their first fundraiser is going to be selling Easter baskets. I have one sort of made up if you want to see what they're like. They're Christ-centered Easter baskets. And you can see that if you just order them, we'd be glad to make them for you. Thank you.
So as you think about Easter baskets, think about grandchildren who are going to get all kinds of candies and bunnies. Maybe there's an alternative here. Come see what Judy has put together. Oh, I'm sorry. I should be over there as a hanger.
What?
I pulled it up.
Oh,
An update on Cisa Bantuana and seamstresses for Cisa Bantuana. You have been so generous, and so many people have come forward wanting to sew dresses for the orphanage and child care center in South Africa, which is, I'm the conduit for my Jefferson Elementary School. We have five teachers going. We've had a relationship with this orphanage for the last 3 years. This year, five teachers have luggage to take things, so that's part of this. But guess what? I brought dresses today. They, during the week, some went out. They're all gone already. So I'll bring more next week. Today, if you're interested, will you come and see me so that I can make sure that you get a kit? Each kit has the fabric pre-cut and the elastic in it. You just need to sew the side seams, the neckline, finish the seams and the hem, and you're done. Right, Tammy? Was it easy? Yes. All right. So anyone can do that. Well, Tammy would tell me if we did a good job making it easy. Yeah. Did we do that?
Yeah.
All right. And then the other pieces, actually, I've had several of you come up and say, well, I can't sew. Is there something else I can do? Well, the children in the building are very engaged in this orphanage. And during their letter writing unit, they will be learning persuasive letters and thank you letters and how to write and format letters. So we're actually looking for people that they can write to with a little persuasion. And if you're interested in that, please come see me.
Thank you.
Good morning. Just another save the date, because I don't have a lot of announcements prepared. April 23rd at 1 o'clock at Cargill United Methodist Church is our 40th annual Crop Hunger Walk. I believe registration starts at 1 o'clock, and then the walk starts at 1:30. So I just want to share that last year, Crop Walk in Janesville raised $45,662.66. We also raised more funds in 2016 than we did in 2015, and so there's this little challenge statement at the bottom. Can we increase again this year? So I know there's a tree in the back you'll see in the narthex window. It's kind of hard because it's all black right now, but we're hoping to put pictures of walkers in those branches. And then I think Kathy has some, and Lori Craig has some pictures from the previous 40 years of Crop Walk that will be showing up on those other two windows. So so now if you need a packet, I will have them with me. Come find me, and I hope I have some better announcements in the future.
All right, so walkers, grab Lori so you could ask people for donations now, because all those Good Shepherd people have already gotten all the... All right.
The best for last. Just to go along with your joke, how many St. John Lutherans does it take to gather downstairs after congregational church today to be a part of our meeting?
All of them.
We got some smart... You guys listen.
Yeah.
We have some treats down there. It's very important. The Natural Church Development team has worked very hard to get to this point. And as you read in the bulletin, we're going to break into small focus groups as the meeting goes on. And just to look for your input on this question, what do you think would help and encourage us to grow in discipleship? And if you think you don't have a voice, you'll find out when you go downstairs that you do. And we're going to keep track of all this information, and we think that'll help us as we move forward. We really want to hear what you're thinking, what you'd like to see, and to help us at St. John's. So, you're most welcome to come down and visit us and be a part of it after church.
Thank you. Just a couple reminders about our midweek worship services. Wednesday night at 7 is preceded at 6 by a simple, very simple soup and bread gathering for meal at 6. And then the same midweek Lenten theme occurs at our midday Thursday worship of Holy Communion. So that is written in your yellow page as well. All right. Anything else to bring to our attention? I'll pause because the director is consulting with the percussion group, the percussion section. The director was consulting the percussion section, I understand. I invite you to stand and we'll sing together our ascending song, Heaven is in My Heart. marked with the cross of Christ, go forth to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.